Okay, good morning everyone. So today we are talking about metal ceramic restorations, right? So I assume that you know what is principles of tooth preparations. We have also studied the different variety or different steps in the crown preparation for all metal crown restoration. Now we are moving one step ahead. Metal ceramic restoration. So before you know, do you know what are metal ceramic restorations? As you can see on the picture, we have metal ceramic restoration picture. So we have to explore what is your metal ceramic restorations. So to have a brief introduction regarding this restoration, now as you can see on your screen, we have a PFM metal porcelain fused to metal crown cross section. Now the portion which is marked with the blue line, this blue line portion mark, that is your metal coping, right? So first of all, we are going to fabricate the metal copings. Once your metal copings are ready, then your technician will send the metal copings to dentist, and the dentist will remove the temporary crown from the oral cavity. He will put this metal coping in the oral cavity. He will check the marginal fit. He will check the occlusion. And once he is satisfied with the metal coping, again, the same coping will be sent back to the laboratory. And now your technician is going to layer this metal coping with ceramic layer. Now whatever is beyond this pink color and the white color, all these are the layers of the ceramic. So we are putting the ceramic layer on the top of your metal coping. That is why it is called as ceramometal restorations or PFM restoration. That is your porcelain fused to metal, right? So this is a brief introduction regarding your PFM restoration. Today's lecture we are going to see what are the indications for your PFM restoration, in which cases they are indicated. Then we are going to see the what are the contraindication, because whenever you have something with you, there are advantages, disadvantages, indications, contraindications. So what are the indications and contraindication, what are the advantages and the disadvantages with your PFM restorations, everything we are going to look in this lecture. Then the last destination for today's lecture will be procedure. What type of steps we are going to follow for your crown preparation for PFM restorations. So to begin, first of all, you should understand that PFM restoration has got strength, right? They have a very good strength because there is a metal coping inside, and you know that metal is a strong material. There are different alloys which are available in dentistry, and by using all kind of alloys, whatever favorable alloy we want, that alloy we will use, and then we can fabricate. So we have a strength because of our metal restoration. Now only strength we don't have, we also have a aesthetic, because we are putting the ceramic layer which is having a same color like your teeth. Now when you put the ceramic layer, the fabrication of that layer, or you can say ceramic buildup, it is giving us opportunity to replicate the same shade what our patient is having. So we have to select the shade when the patient is coming for the first time, first visit, when you take the diagnostic impression. And once you finish your scaling and polishing, then you are supposed to take the shade of that patient. Now, as you are very well aware that we have different varieties of shade. You don't know anything right now regarding the shades because we didn't cover the shade selection. We will cover the shade selection topic in second semester. But for today and for now, I want to tell you that when the patient is coming for the first visit and when you do the diagnostic impression after scaling and polishing, we are supposed to record the shade of the tooth. Now, if you observe every individual, you will come to know that the shade is different at the incisal edge, it is different in the middle edge, and it is different in the cervical portion. in the cervical portion, it is little darker, yellowish in color. And when you come towards the incisal area, it is more translucent, it is more white. Some people, they have some enamel cracks which are developed on their tooth. Some people, they have some kind of white patches, discoloration on the tooth. So all these kind of shade variation we can mimic or we can copy with our ceramic buildup. Fine, understood this? So we have good amount of strength, we have good amount of aesthetic. Fine, so let us move ahead. Now the indications, where are these metal ceramic restorations indicated? Where these metal ceramic restorations are indicated? The first most important indication is whenever you required a complete coverage of crown, in that scenario the metal ceramic restorations are indicated. Now sometimes you have to go for the bridge porcelain, when the tooth are missing, you are supposed to go with the bridge. Now in each and every case we cannot go with the metal restorations because metal doesn't have aesthetic value. So we want something which will have aesthetic value. So this is our first choice, PFM restorations. Now the beauty is that as there is a metal inside, so the strength is already provided by the metal copings. So you can fabricate the bridge, because one thing you have to understand, the ceramic is the most brittle material, right? It doesn't have its own strength. Whatever strength the ceramic have is because of the thickness of the ceramic, and the main strength is gained by your metal coping. Fine. So whenever there is a demand for your crowns and bridges, and the patient is demanding for aesthetic also, or if the restoration you have to give in aesthetic zone, then PFM is your first choice. Second, we have your aesthetic demand, right? Sometimes if the patient is having high lip line, you know what is high lip line? When the patient is smiling, there is a exposure of the gums, right? We can see the cervical area of the patient. Not with every person we can see the cervical area of the person. Like for example, when I smile, when I talk, when I laugh, my cervical area, right, my gingival line is not visible because I don't have high lip line. Fine. But there are some patients who have high lip line, or you know, gummy smile. When they smile, when they talk, all their gums are exposed, right? So that is a gummy style smile. So for such cases, aesthetic requirement at the cervical area is high. Fine. So in such cases, we are not supposed to give with your metal restorations. So for such cases, we are supposed to go with your PFM restoration. Number three we have is your extensive tooth destruction. Now, as you are very well aware, that when you go for the, when the patient is going for the endo treatment, he is coming for the endo treatment when there is extensive carious lesion, the lot of tooth structure has been destroyed because of the carious lesion. Sometimes the tooth get fractures and the endodontist try to restore the tooth, right? So whatever carious lesion is there, he is going to remove that carious lesion, and then he will preserve the tooth structure, the root portion, the pulp, whatever is there, he will first conserve that. Now on the top, whatever is remaining is very less amount of tooth structure is remaining. So now it is our job to restore the remaining tooth structure, and the PFM restorations are the best choice for such kind of restoration. Now coming to the number four, whenever you have some kind of minor correction with the inclination of the teeth, right? In that cases also your PFM restoration will help you, because every case is not indicated for your ortho treatment. Some cases are there where you need some minor correction with the inclinations, and your PFM restoration is going to help you. And the fifth most important we have is your cost effective and durability. As there is a metal coping inside, so automatically the durability of this prosthesis is good, and it is cost effective. If you compare with the all ceramic material, this PFM restorations are cost effective. They are not that expensive. Now these are indications for your PFM restorations. Now we have contraindication as PFM restoration. The first contraindication we have is your patient with active caries, right? Whenever you have a patient who have an active caries activity present in the oral cavity, such cases are not indicated for any kind of restoration. It could be your metal restoration, PFM restoration, all ceramic restoration, whatever restoration. Any active caries activity present in the oral cavity doesn't indicate to go for your any kind of restoration, and this is true for your PFM restoration as well. Then is your untreated periodontal condition. If your patient is having some kind of periodontal issues present in the oral cavity, you are not supposed to go with the PFM restoration or any kind of restoration. First, you are supposed to treat that periodontal condition. Once you have a healthy environment in the oral cavity, then and then only you can plan for your PFM restoration. Number three contraindication is your large pulp chamber. Now, as you can see in the diagram, when the patient is young, the size of the pulp chamber is bigger, right? So when you want to go with your PFM restorations with such young individuals, you are going near to the pulp structure. So your patient might develop pulpitis, he might develop sensitivity, and we don't want that. So there, these cases are not indicated for your PFM restoration. So, and as there is a increase in the age, the size of the pulp chamber shrinks. As you can see in this picture, the size of the pulp chamber is shrinking. Now at this age, the age of this patient is around 30 and above, 30 years and above. So in such cases, PFM restorations are indicated. Even at this stage also, they are indicated. This is the age 25 to 30 years. So in such cases also, your PFM restorations are indicated. But you have a young individual sitting on the chair and demanding for the PFM restorations, you have to think twice, because the pulp chamber is bigger. So that is a contraindication. Then we have, whenever there is a availability of conservative retainer, as you can see in the below picture, there is a availability of conservative option, right? These are called as Maryland bridges, where we are not preparing the abutment. Only the palatal portion is prepared, and by taking support and by putting your retainers on the palatal portion of your adjacent tooth, you are replacing the missing tooth. You are putting the pontic, right? So these are called as Maryland bridges. These are conservative approach, because we are not touching the incisal edge, we are not touching the labial portion. So they are more conservative. So whenever you have opportunity to give some conservative options, go with that. Don't give for PFM restorations, because for PFM restoration, you have to cut the tooth, and this removal of the tooth structure is little excess as compared to metal. Fine, because in metal we have seen that on functional cusp the reduction should be 1.5 millimeter, and in PFM restorations we want functional cusp reduction around 2 millimeters. So here there is more reduction. Same is with other surfaces also. We will see in depth what are the reduction dimensions for PFM restoration. The intention for telling you this is, for PFM restoration you need to remove excess amount of tooth structure. So you have to think very wisely. If you have other options available, go with that. Don't go with your PFM restoration. So all these are your contraindications for your PFM restorations. Now coming to the advantages, basically we have four advantages. Number one is your strength of the casted metal, right? Because as I said in my second or third slide, the PFM restoration has got good amount of strength because there is a metal coping inside which gives the strength. Now on the top of that metal coping, we are putting the ceramic layer or porcelain layer. We are veneering this coping with the help of some porcelain material, and the beauty of that porcelain is we can mimic or we can copy the exact shade for our patient. Number three, we have retentive quality, as we are removing all the axial surfaces, all the occlusal surfaces, so you have ample amount of surface area available. And as we have studied in principles of tooth preparation, we have more surface area, we have more retention and resistance. So the retentive quality with your PFM restorations are very good. And the last one is easy correction of the axial surface. Now, if you remember, I said we can correct some degree of inclination. So this is applied here. If there is a need for axial correction with your tooth, we can do that correction with your PFM restoration, because we are removing the tooth structure from all the surfaces. So if you want to correct some axial inclination, labial or lingual inclination little bit in small quantity, you have that opportunity to correct that inclination with your PFM restoration. So all these are the advantages with your PFM restoration. Now coming advantages. What are the disadvantages with your PFM restoration? Number one, metal crown is subject to brittle fracture. As I said before, your ceramic is very brittle material. It doesn't have its own strength. Whatever strength it have is because of the thickness of the ceramic and because of the coping metal substructure which is inside. That gives strength to your PFM restorations, right? So this is a kind of disadvantage with your PFM restoration. There are chances of fracturing or chipping off of the ceramic layer, right? Which is very common problem. Sometimes your technician doesn't follow the proper instructions which are given by the ceramic company. So he intentionally or not intentionally, basically unintentionally, if he committed any mistake at the time of firing of the ceramic, chipping of the ceramic is the common problem. Second thing is that if a operator is new, now we people are budding dentists, so we are new for the preparation. So when we do the preparation, there are certain rules for doing the preparation. If you don't obey the rules for your PFM restorations, you might not give proper dimensions, proper preparation area for your PFM restoration, and your technician doesn't have opportunity to build the ceramic layer, because for giving the aesthetic result, he needs some kind of thickness for your ceramic layer. And if your preparations are not sufficient, your technician would not able to give a proper layering of the ceramic. So either he will make the crown bulky, which is going to compromise other things like periodontal condition, or there will be encroachment of the space which is not meant for that crown. So all these type of complications will be there. So this is a disadvantage. Then slightly inferior aesthetic compared to all ceramic, right? It is little bit inferior as compared to all ceramic. There are some drawbacks with your PFM restoration, with your porcelain fused to metal restoration. As you go cervically, the thickness of the ceramic layer reduces, right? And there is a reflection of the metal coping shade outside. So it looks greenish in the cervical area. So that is a kind of disadvantage with your PFM restorations. Then we have some gingival finish line. Now, as the number two point is there, it is more as it is inferior aesthetic as compared to all ceramic, right? Why? Because as I said, that in the cervical portion, the thickness of your PFM restoration is less. So there is a scope of reflection of that metal coping layer, which is black outside, right? So there is a greenish effect in the cervical area. Now, to avoid this, what we have to do is we have to go with the subgingival finish line, right? Now, in principles of tooth preparation, we have seen there are different location of your finish line. Number one was your supragingival, which is one of the best type of finish line, because it is easy to fabricate, easy to prepare, everything is visible. Second thing is, it is easy for our technician to fabricate the wax pattern. And number three is, the hygiene maintenance for supragingival finish line is very easy, because everything is above the gingiva. Second variety we have is equigingival finish line, that is, you are at the level of the gingiva. That this is also acceptable, because everything is visible. The moment you go beyond that limit, that is your subgingival finish line, your biological width will come into picture. Now, what is biological width? Everybody knows that. We are not supposed to compromise the biological width. So whenever you are going with the subgingival finish line, first of all, you are supposed to think of that biological width. And when you are going for the subgingival margin, the first of all, the preparation is a bit difficult for the operator, right? Now, apart from this, after cementation, after placing the PFM restoration in the oral cavity, you will not have aesthetic problem because everything is hidden beneath the marginal gingiva because of this subgingival finish line. But the thing is that your patient has to properly follow the post-cementation instruction. Whatever instructions you are supposed to give, like for whenever we go for any surgery, after surgery, your surgeon is going to give you certain instructions and we are following that instruction. It is for our betterment. Similarly, in prosthetics also, once you place the prosthesis, once you deliver the prosthesis, like for complete denture, for RPD, for crown or for bridge, whatever, the moment you give the prosthesis to the patient, there are certain instructions that has been followed by your patient in future. That is good for his durability of the prosthesis. For his good, we are telling him the instruction. Now, what are that instruction? Maintain the oral hygiene properly. Why? Because if he is not maintaining oral hygiene properly, he will develop some kind of periodontal problems which might influence the abutment. And all our durability of restoration depends on the abutment. If the abutment is loose or moving, our restoration, our prosthesis will come out. So we depend on him, we depend on the periodontium, we depend on the hygiene of the patient. So you are supposed to tell him that you are supposed to maintain the hygiene properly. So in subgingival type of finish line, you are meticulously tell your patient that the hygiene should be properly followed, otherwise there will be failure. The last disadvantage we have is significant amount of tooth reduction you have to do. As I said earlier, that for the metal crown preparation, the amount of reduction is less. Whereas when you go for the PFM restoration reduction, the amount of tooth reduction is more. So there is significant amount of tooth reduction. So it is not a conservative type of preparation. Am I clear with this? Now, before you start with the preparation, there are certain things to be remembered. So the faulty tooth preparation may lead to over contouring of the restoration. Now, as you can see in this picture, this restoration, this central incisor is bit bulky, over contoured. Because of this bulk, now there are many reasons the crown is bulky. This could be because of your preparation, faulty preparation, or this could be your technician didn't fabricate the crown properly. So there are n number of reasons for that. But whatever reason is there, it is going to have problem with your periodontium, right? The gingival inflammation will be there because it is going to have problem for our periodontium. Then we have poor aesthetic because there is an inflammation. There might be your recession of gingiva in this cervical area. And because of this recession, the aesthetic value will be lowered. So there will be poor aesthetic. And as there will be open margin, so there could be marginal leakage in future. Maybe after 6 months, maybe after 1 year, you never know. But if this happens, there will be loss of retention. So retentive qualities will be loose, or maybe after 1 year, 2 years, or 1.5 year, your patient will come along with the tooth in his hand. Doctor, my crown came out. Why? Because all these are the reasons. So these things you have to keep in mind. If you go with the faulty tooth preparations, if you did the faulty tooth preparation, anything can happen or all the things can happen, right? You cannot predict what will happen. All questions I will take at the end. PFM tooth preparations dictated by the first, length of the preparation for adequate retention and resistance. First of all, this length is very important, right? Now, if you observe here, it is not in one plane. There are two planes. If you observe the cross section of your natural tooth, you will come to know that we have two planes. One is your occlusal one-third portion, cervical one-third portion. In another slide, we have that. Then we have thickness of the ceramic veneer for desired aesthetic. Now, as I said before, that whenever you want to duplicate something, shade of the adjacent tooth or remaining tooth, you need certain amount of ceramic thickness. If this thickness is compromised, I am talking about this thickness. If this thickness is compromised, our technicians are unable to mimic or copy the exact shade which we have selected for that case. So this is a problem. Then occlusal clearance for function and anterior guidance. Now what is anterior guidance? Already you have studied in your dental occlusion, so I will not go in depth. So occlusal clearance means we have to do the certain amount of occlusal clearance on the functional cusp. We have to do the certain amount of occlusal clearance with the functional cusp. So there are fixed guidelines for this occlusal clearance. Why we want this fixed guideline? Because we want strength, sufficient amount of strength along with the aesthetic in this stressed area. We don't want chipping of the enamel because of the stresses. So that particular amount of thickness is very important. So the tooth preparation is dictated by all these three things. I will take all the questions at the end. Okay. Coming to the steps in the crown preparation. Steps in the crown preparation for anterior tooth are little different, and for the posterior tooth they are little different, right? So first we will see what are the steps which are involved for your, then we will proceed. But before that, let us talk regarding the arma mentarium, right? Now the arma mentariums are common for your PFM restoration. Only thing is there is an addition of this new burr. If you observe here, this is tapered flattened burr, right? And this is our tapered rounded burr that we have used for your metal crown preparation, because there we wanted chamfer finish line all around, on the buccal chamfer, on the palatal chamfer and on the proximal chamfer. But in PFM restoration there are certain rules. On the buccal side we have either shoulder, radial shoulder or shoulder with bevel, right? And on the palatal side we want your chamfer finish line. So for this preparation you need to add one extra member in the family of your arma mentarium, that is your tapered flat end burr. Now this is the burr which is your flame shape burr. It is used to reduce the occlusal surface and the cingulum portion of, with your anterior tooth. This is your needle end burr you used for proximal reduction to break the contact point without damaging the adjacent tissues or adjacent tooth. Then we have tapered round end burr to round off all the angles and to prepare the chamfer finish line. And for shoulder finish line we have tapered flat end. So these are the families of burr we are supposed to use, and I advise you purchase all these kind of burrs in bulk. Bulk means in large quantity, 10 10 10, each burr 10 10 10, because we have to use these burrs throughout the year. So you should have your own stuff ready with you, because if your weapons are good you can fight well. Then we have a periodontal probe, as you can see in the picture. Periodontal probe we use to check the occlusal clearance and to check the finish line, whether the finish line is smooth or not. Sometimes it is rough. That roughness may be because your burrs are dull, there are no diamond particles present on this surface, so it will not cut your tooth surface and you will get rough surface. So to evaluate that we need a periodontal burr. And the last member we have your off angle hatchet. This is your off angle hatchet. Sometimes you have to properly prepare the finish line with the help of this off angle hatchet, right? So these are the armamentarium you should have at the time of your preparation. Now coming to the steps. First we will talk about anterior crown. Now there are five major steps: guiding grooves, incisal reduction, labial or buccal reduction, axial reduction or proximal reduction, and then final finishing of your preparation. So let us see one by one how we are. First of all, we are supposed to go with your guiding grooves. Now for making the guiding grooves or incisal grooves, we are supposed to put this incisal reduction, depth orientation groove also you can call it. It is 1.8 millimeter, right? So you are supposed to put this groove 1.8 millimeter. But our incisal reduction for PFM restoration is 2 millimeter. And here we are putting the depth orientation groove 1.8 millimeter because 0.2 millimeter of dimension is required at the time of finishing. So during finishing, you might reduce 0.2 millimeter and you will get a proper occlusal incisal reduction, exactly 2 millimeter. And that you have to check with the help of your periodontal probe. So this is your guiding grooves for reduction. So now, as you can see in this picture, there is an incisal reduction. Whatever guiding grooves we have placed, we have removed the tooth material which was there in between the depth orientation groove, and we got 2 millimeter of incisal reduction. Then we have to proceed with the facial reduction. Now there are certain rules for your facial. First of all, you should understand the cross section. If you see the cross section of the tooth, you will come to know that this tooth is not in a one plane. It is curved, right? So it is in two plane. Cervical portion is there and incisal portion is there, right? So the reduction what you will be doing on the facial surface will be according to these surfaces. So first of all, you are supposed to give the incisal two-third depth orientation groove with the help of your tapered round end burr. Only incisal two-third portion is in contact with the burr, right? This cervical one-third portion is not in contact with the burr. Understood? Then once you do this, then you have to continue the same with the help of your tapered again round end burr. That this is your cervical one-third portion. Now when you give this cervical one-third portion facial depth orientation groove, your burr is not touching to the occlusal surface or incisal surface, right? So we have given the reduction in two plane. Now as you can see in that diagram, you will come to know that the angulation of burr is different. Why? Because we are doing the reduction in that plane, in that two planes only. If you do the reduction in one plane, there will be mess. So this is clear with everyone, right? So this angulation of the burr, you are supposed to change the angulation of the burr by your own hand, by your own hand movement. So that is why you should have control on your hand while doing the preparation. So please concentrate on your preparation when you do the reductions. Do not chat or do not divert your mind with your mobile or with anyone. Please concentrate only and only on the tooth reduction. You have to do this for only one semester. Once you have that amount of skill developed in your mind with your hand, then everything will be easy for you. Am I clear?
Yes.
Fine. So I hope this is clear with everyone. So let us move. Then coming to the axial reduction. First of all, on the buccal side or on the labial side, you are supposed to develop the shoulder finish line. As you can see in this picture, we have developed the shoulder finish line. And for shoulder finish line, we need to have a tapered round end burr, right? Now, if you remember in my previous slide, last slide, I told you that for putting the facial depth orientation groove, we need to use tapered round end burr, and here we are using tapered flat end burr. Am I right?
Yes.
Can anybody tell me why we are doing that? No? Chamfer finish line needs less reduction. Shoulder finish line needs more reduction, right? So when you give depth orientation groove and when you do the reduction of the facial surface, you are supposed to use chamfer finish line or tapered round end burr, not chamfer finish line, tapered round end burr, because that burr doesn't cut much amount of tooth structure. There is a scope of correction, right? Because if you do over reduction, it's not like something we will mix some kind of enamel with some liquid and then we will put it like a composite. Can we do that? No, we cannot do that. Once you reduce, that is permanent, irreversible. We cannot reverse the condition. So right from the beginning, we are supposed to keep in mind that this is irreversible condition. Once we reduce the tooth structure, we cannot have any control on that reduction. So it is better right from the beginning, be conservative. That is why right from the beginning, we are using tapered round end burr because it is cutting the tooth structure in less quantity. Once you are done with the facial reduction, then we have to develop the finish line. And for developing this finish line, we are supposed to use tapered flat end burr, because this tapered flat end burr will create a shoulder finish line. Now, what is shoulder? You already know that, so I will not explain it again. So this shoulder you are supposed to prepare in the buccal side or labial side. Understood? Now, when you do this shoulder preparation, make sure your burr is having contact only and only in the cervical 1/3 portion. This burr should not touch to the occlusal 2/3 portion. This portion is not touched by the burr when you are preparing your finish line. Because if this burr will touch this surface, your middle portion will be over reduced and you will not get your preparation in two plane. It will be in one plane. I will tell you what will happen if the preparation is in one plane. So this is regarding your labial side. Now coming to the palatal side. For palatal side, we want chamfer finish line. And for chamfer finish line, which burr we are using? Tapered round end burr. So once you are done with your buccal finish line and your palatal finish line, then is the time for your cingulum portion reduction. And for cingulum portion reduction, we have a flame shaped burr. So the shape of this burr is in such a way that it will be properly reducing your cingulum portion. Then for the proximal portion, first of all, you are supposed to break the contact point with the help of your needle end burr without damaging the adjacent tooth. You have two methods. Either you can go with your enamel lipping method, where you keep a small portion of intact enamel wall in the proximal area. And second method, you can put your metal bands to protect the adjacent tooth. Once you get a space for your tapered round end burr to prepare the chamfer finish line, then you can shift the burr. But first reduction should be done by your needle end burr. Now, axial reduction and finishing polishing. Now, these dimensions you are supposed to remember. In the cervical area, the thickness of your reduction should be 1.5 millimeter. And here I have written 1.5 millimeter, but in literature it is mentioned 1.2 to 1.5 millimeter. Then as you go towards the cervical area, the thickness is same, because if you follow this two plane preparation, then this thickness will be same. Otherwise, this thickness, 1.5 millimeter thickness in the incisal portion, will increase if you don't follow the two plane preparation. Then in the incisal area, the thickness is 2 millimeter, because here there are maximum amount of forces which are going to act in the incisal portion. This is one reason. Second reason is the translucency of your ceramic should be developed with your ceramic layer. So that for that reason, we should have good amount of ceramic clearance in the incisal area. Then as you move towards the palatal side, the thickness gets reduced and it is 1 to 1.5 millimeter. In the cingulum portion, in this portion, it is around 1.2 to 1 millimeter. And the above the chamfer finish line, this height of your preparation should be 1.5 millimeter minimum height. Then and then only you can get excess amount of surface area. And when you have excess amount of surface area, your retention and resistance quality with your restorations will be excellent. Now, as you can see in this picture, we have chamfer finish line, shoulder finish line, we have axial reduction. So what exactly this shoulder is going to do? For example, the shoulder will give marginal integrity, right? When you prepare shoulder, you will have marginal integrity of your restoration. Then there will be structural durability. This restoration will be very strong, because shoulder, when you prepare the shoulder, the thickness is more with the restoration. So there will be structural durability. Coming to the chamfer, we have marginal integrity. But here structural durability is not that good as compared to your shoulder. That doesn't mean that chamfer doesn't have structural durability. Your chamfer is also having structural durability, but here we are comparing with the shoulder. So that is why we have not written structural durability on the side of chamfer.
Then coming to the wings. Now these are the wings which you have to prepare in your preparation. Some says you are supposed to prepare the wings, some says don't prepare the wings. So it completely depend on the operator. So what these wings are going to do, it is going to give you extra retention and resistance, because as they are having the grooves, wings, right? Same like your retentive grooves. Retentive groove, you understand? I taught you in principles of tooth preparation. So these wings are like your retentive grooves, right? So when you give the retentive grooves or when you prepare the wings, excess amount of tooth structure you will get. And when there is an excess amount of surface area, automatically it is going to reflect with your retention and resistance quality of your restoration. Incisal notch, when you round off this incisal area, automatically you will get the structural durability because the thickness will increase in this area. Axial reduction, resistance and retention and structural durability. If you have a proper thickness, 1.5 millimeter proper reduction with proper plane, automatically all these things will be reflected with your restoration. Now let us see what is going to be happened if you don't follow the preparation in two planes. Right now, as you can see in this first picture, our preparation is in two plane. This is your cervical two-third preparation, and this is your this is cervical one-third preparation, and this is your incisal two-third preparation. So it is in two plane. So this is what we want in our preparation. Then only you can get proper aesthetic value, proper durability with your restoration. If you do a preparation in single plane, now in second diagram what you see, our preparation is in single plane. So if you observe in the incisal portion, the thickness of ceramic is less. So as there is a less thickness of the ceramic, whatever the shade your metal coping is having, that will be reflected outside. So aesthetic value will be reduced. Second thing is, when you have this type of preparation in one plane, there could be over contouring of your restoration. If there is a over contouring with your restoration, there will be aesthetic problem, or there could be your periodontal problem, right? So we don't want that. Third thing is that when you have your preparation in one plane, you might land up near to the pulp area, and there could be sensitivity or pulpitis, reversible or irreversible. This could be developed. So we don't want these type of mistake happen with our preparation. So am I clear with this, everyone?
Yes.
Right. Okay. So this is what we want. When you see from the occlusal portion, there should be no undercut at all. Proper tapering should be there with your preparation. No undercut, right? Proper tapering, over tapering I don't want. We want proper tapering. Proper clearance should be there. So when you have this kind of picture with your preparation, then these are the good preparations. Coming to the second step, that is your posterior preparation. So let us see. Steps are nearly same for your posterior preparations. Number one is your guiding groove, then is your occlusal reduction. Depth orientation grooves first you have to do, then you have to do the occlusal reduction. All these steps we have already done with your metal restorations or metal preparations. We are doing with your metal restoration. Only thing is, here the dimensions are more. Here you are supposed to remove more material, right? So guiding grooves, occlusal reduction, then we have buccal reduction. After that, axial reduction will be there. And lastly, we will be finishing our preparation. Whatever unfinished surfaces or rough surfaces are there, it has to be properly finished. So if let us see what are the steps. First is your depth hole. Now as you can see in this picture, these are the depth hole. Now when you prepare your access cavity opening, you are using round burr. Am I clear? Round burr you are using. Same type of round burr you are supposed to use to put the depth hole. Fine. It is optional. It is up to you whether you want to put it or not. It is up to you. But when you are a beginner, better to put the depth hole followed by your depth orientation groove. These depth orientation grooves already we have done, right? The depth depends around 1.5 to 1.8 millimeter, depend on the surface. If it is on the functional cusp, it will be more. If it is on the non-functional cusp, it will be less. So once you have a depth orientation groove, then you are supposed to remove the tooth material which is there in between the depth orientation groove, and then you have to prepare the functional cusp bevel. For the palatal posteriors, the functional cusp bevel should be given on the palatal cusp, and on the mandibular teeth, the functional cusp bevel is given on the buccal side. Right, very good. So once you finish reduction, then we have your palatal preparation, that where you will create your chamfer finish line. And for creating your chamfer finish line, you will be using tapered round end burr. Once you finish this, then you will move towards the buccal portion. And for buccal portion, your finish line will be shoulder preparation. For shoulder preparation, you will be using tapered flat end burr. And then you will be joining the buccal reduction with the palatal reduction. And then your preparation will be complete. After completion of the preparation, your preparation should look like this. And the wings I was talking about, this is the wings which I was talking about, right? So these wings are like your retentive grooves. So it depends on the operator whether you want to put the retentive grooves or whether you want to prepare the wings or not. If you don't prepare the wings, that is also okay. You can merge the shoulder and the chamfer finish line all together. That will be now. Finishing of the preparations, there are certain points that has to be remembered for finishing of your preparation. First of all, the line angles, all line angles should be round off, right? Now, I will advise when you are doing the preparation in our Phantom Lab, I will advise you properly wear the gloves, or you can remove the gloves, and with your finger, index finger, try to check the roughness of your preparation. Or sharp angle, you can feel that sharpness with your index finger. If you feel there is a sharpness, you are supposed to round off that angle, right? So that is called as finishing of the preparation, of rounding off of the sharp angles. Am I clear?
Yes.
Right. It is something that you have to feel, okay? Then finishing line should be smooth and continuous circumferentially. All around the finish line should be uniform. Somewhere it is very big, somewhere it is very small. It's not like that. This is not the way we are supposed to do that reduction. If you do that, you are going to compromise the principles, right? So finish line should be smooth, continuous, and circumferentially covering throughout the circumference. Finish the margin with off angle hatchet, right? At the beginning stage, you can use this, but in clinics, it's up to you. Any unsupported enamel to a structure should be removed before taking final impression. Avoid creating any undercut. So proper tapering is very important. Variations in your shoulder finish line. Now I taught you regarding the finish line. So there are variations with every preparation. Basically, we have classification of finish line based on the design. We have chamfer, shoulder, and your needle end. That's it. Khalas. But in chamfer, you have different variations. In shoulder, you have different variations, right? It is like your model number. In we have iPhone 11 and we have different models. Some have 128 GB, some have 256, some have 500, some have more than that, right? So these are the different variations. So same kind of variation we have with shoulder, right? So first of all, we have the commonest type is your 90 degree shoulder, right? This is the commonest way of preparing the shoulder, what you can prepare with your normal tapered flat end burr. Then we have another variation with this is your 120 degree angulation with your shoulder, right? So as you can see here, the angle is around 120 degree. And the third variation we have is slightly different, right? This is your shoulder with bevel. As you can see in this diagram, this is unsupported enamel tooth structure before. So we have given a bevel to remove the unsupported enamel tooth structure, right? So this is all our variations with your shoulder. Understood? Because some whenever you go for some conferences, or whenever you are attending some webinars, you might come these type of terminologies. Don't get confused, right? They might say 90 degree shoulder, they might say 120 degree shoulder, they might say shoulder with bevel. So don't get confused. These are the different variation with your shoulder finish line that has to be given. Any of the option you can give with your preparation. Am I clear? Now, the dimensions of your preparation. As you can see on the functional cusp, we have 2 mm of occlusal clearance. On the non-functional cusp, we have 1.5 mm of occlusal clearance. Right, so this is your occlusal surface reduction. Then we have a functional cusp bevel properly given at 45 degree angulation. Automatically that will give you extra space, which is 2 mm at the functional cusp area. Then you will give the facial reduction. Now facial reduction, you are supposed to give it in two planes, as I said. Now in our preparation, what we are doing in our pre-clinics, generally we people are making this common mistake. We are doing our reduction in one plane, right? Have you experienced this? Many students, whenever they show me preparation, I tell it is in one plane or you did over reduction. So I was talking about this. Your buccal preparation should be in two plane, cervical portion and your occlusal portion. So please try to follow the morphology of the tooth. So your morphology of the tooth will guide your preparations. So the clearance is around 1.5 millimeter and on the palatal side we have chamfer finish line. So this is all our preparation. This is how our should look like, right? Now coming to the tapering. Now if you see in this diagram, uniform 6 to 10 degree of tapering should be there with your preparation. If your tapering is beyond 10 degree, right, it is acceptable. Till 18 degree it is acceptable, but the moment you cross 10 degree, the quality of retention will start losing, right? And the losing curve is something like this. It is not dropping completely, but the moment you cross your tapering 22 degree, the retention and resistance curve will flatten if you give over tapering. Understood? So optimum tapering is around 6 to 10 degree. Now when you read the books, they have mentioned different taperings. Some says 4 degree taper, some say 5 degree taper, some say 12 degree taper, 16 degree taper, 18 degree taper. So you have to think, analyze. Wherever they have written this, they have given the references. References, you understand, they have given some proof. Some study has been conducted in past and they have taken all that information from that study. That is your reference. So you have to go and see, at least see the name of that reference, who did that study and what kind of study was done on that tooth, right? So that will tell you what type of tapering we need for our preparation. But ideal cases, whenever anybody asks you at this level, your answer should be 6 to 10 degree of uniform taper should be present with your preparation. Now this is the diagram which is going to tell you what type of functions this is. This is going to tell you, so this already you know, so I'll not go in depth. This is the reduction what we are supposed to do. So this reduction, it depends on the how much amount of ceramic we have put. Like for example, 1.5 mm of ceramic is there and 0.5 mm of metal is there. So we have separate everything. All the thickness of your restoration has been separated, right? So this is all about your PFM restoration preparations. What we have learned today, indications and contraindications. Then we have learned what are the advantages, disadvantages, and the steps to be carried out at the time of your preparation. And what are the care to be taken, what type of preparation we want, and what sort of preparation is to be avoided with your preparation. So this is all about your PFM restorations. Now I will take your questions. We have 5 minutes to finish your questions. Go ahead.
I was asking about the leak which you mentioned in the over contouring and the anterior teeth.
Okay.